black body swinging in the southern breeze. Strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees. Pastoral scene of the gallant south. The bulging eyes and the twisted mouth. Scent of magnolia. Then the sudden smell of burning flesh. Here is a fruit for the crows to pluck, for the rain to gather, for the wind to suck, for the sun to rot, for the tree.
Declare our right on this earth to be a man, to be a human being, to be respected as a human being, to be given the rights of a human being in this society, on this earth, in this day, which we intend to bring into existence by any means necessary.
Niggas.
Niggas are scared of revolution.
Niggas.
But niggas shouldn't be scared of revolution.
Niggas. All niggas.
Because
niggas.
Revolution is nothing but niggas. Change. And all niggas do
all
is change. Niggas.
Niggas
come in for murk
niggas.
And change into pimping clothes. The industries to make
niggas.
Some quick change.
Niggas,
niggas change their
niggas.
Hair from black
all
to red
niggas.
To blonde.
Niggas.
And old black hair that looks
niggas.
Will change. Niggas,
niggas
kill other niggas,
niggas.
Just because one
niggas.
Didn't receive the
niggas.
Correct change.
Niggas,
niggas change from men
niggas.
To women, from women
niggas.
To men. Niggas
change,
change, change.
Change.
You hear niggas say, things are changing, things are changing, yeah, things are changing. Nigga things into black nigga things, black nigga things that go through all kinds of changes. The change in the day that makes it madden and rave, black power, and the change that comes over them at night as they sigh and moan.
Right
side, ooh, right side. Niggas always going through bullshit change, but when it comes for real change, niggas are scared. Revolution.
The injustice that has been inflicted upon Negroes in this country by Uncle Sam is criminal.
Niggas, niggas are actors.
Niggas,
niggas are actors.
Niggas,
niggas
actors.
Act like they're in a hurry.
Niggas.
They catch the first
niggas.
Act of the great white hope.
Niggas,
niggas try to act like Malcolm.
Actors.
And when a white man
actors.
Doesn't react toward
niggas.
Them like he did,
actors.
Malcolm, niggas want to act violently.
Niggas.
Niggas act so cool.
Niggas.
And slick, causing white people to say, what makes them niggas act like that? Nobody act before. But when it comes to acting out revolution,
cool.
Niggas say,
I can't dig in action.
Niggas are scared
niggas.
Of revolution.
I'm not an integrationist. Never could be. I couldn't integrate with my enemy. And I know who my enemy is.
Niggas are very untogether people.
Niggas
talk about getting high and riding around in ales.
Niggas
to get high and ride to hell. Niggas talk about pimping, pimping that, pimping what? Pimping yours, pimping mine. Just to be pimping is a hell of a line. Niggas are very untogether people. Niggas are players. Niggas are players, are players. Niggas play football, baseball, and basketball while the white man is cutting off their balls. Niggas tell you they're ready to be liberated, but when you say, let's go take our liberation, niggas reply, I was just playing. Niggas are playing with revolution and losing. Niggas are scared of revolution.
We don't want to have anything to do with any race of dog, two-legged dog, that will fix four-legged dogs on innocent, harmless, women, children, and babies.
Niggas are lovers, are lovers, are lovers. Niggas love to hear Malcolm rap, but they didn't love Malcolm. Niggas love everything but themselves. niggas. I love niggas because niggas are me, and I should only love that which is me. I love to see niggas go through changes, love to see niggas act, love to see niggas make them plays and shoot the shit. But there's one thing about niggas I do not love. Niggas are scared of revolution.
We declare our right on this earth to be a man, to be a human being, to be respected as a human being, to be given the rights of a human being in this society, on this earth, in this day, which we intend to bring into existence by any means necessary. I charge the white man. I charge him with being the greatest murderer on earth. I charge the white man with being the greatest kidnapper on earth. I charge the white man with being the greatest robber and enslaver on earth. I charge the white man with being the greatest adulterer, swine eater, and drunkard on earth.
The Christian religion has failed. Your leader, not that religion, has failed.
Right, dear God.
Now the government of America has failed you. You have no justice coming from no one.
Right.
Well, number one, he teaches us that that never was a real serpent.
It was not a real serpent.
That went into the garden.
What was it?
But as you know, the Bible is written in symbols and parables, and this serpent or snake is a symbol that's used to hide the real identity of the one whom that actually was.
Well, who was it?
The white man. He teaches us that the black man, by nature, is divine.
Now, does this mean that the white man, by nature, is evil?
By nature, he is other than divine.
Well, now, does this mean that he's evil? Can he do good?
By nature, he is evil.
My earliest recollection is of being snatched awake in the middle of the night because our house was on fire. My mother was a West Indian from Grenada, and my father, a Millicent Baptist minister and follower of Marcus Garvey, preached race pride and separation from the white man. The lancing arm of the Ku Klux Klan warned him to stop preaching Garvey's message, but my father was not a frightened Negro, and he kept on. Next thing, he was found with his head bashed in, lying across the streetcar tracks. A trolley had nearly cut him in half. After my father's death, my mother couldn't find work because the Christian people of Lansing wouldn't hire the widow of a crazy nigger. We were so hungry, we were dizzy. We stole to stay alive. It was too much for her. They put her in a mental institution and parceled out us kids to reform schools, charities, and homes.
Minister Malcolm, you now in Chicago and in Detroit have universities of Islam, do you not?
Yes, sir, in Detroit and Chicago.
And you take your parishioners, you take children from the kindergarten ages, and you train them right through high school.
Yes, sir. From the age of four, I think it is, upward.
And you have a certified parochial school operating in Chicago?
In Chicago
and in Detroit.
And in Detroit. Yes.
And kids come to your school in lieu of going to what we would call regular day school?
Yes, sir, many.
What do you teach them there?
We teach them the same things that they would be taught ordinarily in school, minus the little black Sambo story and things that were taught to you and me when we were coming up to breathe that inferiority complex in us.
I'll never forget the man who taught me English in the eighth grade. He told us to think about what we wanted to be. I said, I wanted to be a lawyer. He said, you need to think about something you can be, like a carpenter. You've got good grades, Malcolm, and people like you, but a lawyer is not a realistic goal. And you've got to be realistic, Malcolm. You're a nigger.
Them that's got shall have. Them that's not shall lose. So the Bible said, and it still is news. Mama may have, Papa may have. God bless the child that's got his own, that's got his own. Yes, the strong gets more. while the weak ones fade. Empty pockets don't ever make the grade. Mama may have, Papa may have, but God bless the child that's got his own. That's got his own.
You can go to any little Muslim child and ask him where is hell or who is the devil, and he wouldn't tell you that hell is down in the ground.
The devil is not a little man with horns on whispering in your ear, or a spirit you can't see. But the devil is the white man who was grafted from the black man 6,000 long years ago.
He'll tell you hell is right where he has been catching it, and he'll tell you who the one who is responsible for him having received this hell is the devil.
And he would say that this devil is the white man.
Yes.
In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, to whom all praises is due.
Muhammad makes it imperative that a black man who becomes a Muslim works.
Right.
Get off the welfare.
Right.
Get out of that compensation line.
Right.
Be a man.
Right.
Earn what you need for your own family.
Right.
Then your family respects you.
That's right.
They are proud to say, that's my father.
That's right.
She's proud to say, that's my husband.
Yeah.
Father means you're taking care of those children.
Right.
Just because you made them, that don't mean you're a father. Anybody can make a baby.
Right.
But anybody can't take care of them.
That's right.
Anybody can go and get a woman.
Yeah.
But anybody can't take care of a woman.
Right. Right.
So husband means you are taking care of your wife.
Right.
Father means you are taking care of your children.
Right.
You are accepting the responsibilities of manhood.
Right. Right.
This is the type of teaching that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad teaches us.
That's right.
And this white press has got the nerve to point at him as a hate teacher.
I believe that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad met God face to face.
My name is James 52A. My people have been robbed of their names, their language, and their culture by the white man. Therefore, we use this X, which represents the unknown. This X nullifies our slave name. And until Allah or the Honorable Elijah Muhammad gives us our correct name, we will use the X.
The Honorable Elijah Muhammad teaches us that there is one God, he has one religion, and that he gave this one religion, the same religion, to all of his prophets. Which means Abraham was a Muslim, Lot was a Muslim, Noah was a Muslim, Moses was a Muslim, Daniel was a Muslim, Jesus was a Muslim, all were Muslims. All practiced the religion of Islam, and all were black men. None of them were white. You cannot name one prophet, please. You cannot name one prophet in the Bible that came from Europe. No prophet came from Europe. The prophets all came from Africa and Asia.
The messenger of the Lord of the world, the most honorable Elijah Muhammad, as I greet you.
I want to show you, my people, the way out to your salvation. This problem is to be solved by God, and the solution of the problem has been given to me.
Never has a prophet been a white man.
When I said that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad has a solution to this 400-year-old problem, and that this is a divine solution that has been given to him by God. When America says, in God we trust, she means she trusts in that white God who showed her how to steal this country from the dark-skinned Indians, who showed her how to kidnap you and me and bring us over here and make us slaves.
We invested 310 years of slave labor, 310 years, every day of which your and my mother and father worked for nothing. Not 8 hours a day. There was no union in that day. They worked from sun up until sundown. From can't see in the morning until can't see at night. They never had a day off. And on Sunday, they were allowed to sit down and sing about when they die, they wouldn't be slaves no more. When they die.
This is our investment. This is our contribution. Our blood. Not only did we give of our free labor, we gave of our blood. Every time he had a call to arms, we were the first ones in uniform. We died on every battlefield the white man had. We have made a greater sacrifice than anybody who's standing up in America today. We have made a greater contribution and have collected less. Have collected less.
This is who she means when she says, "In God we trust." That blue-eyed God, that blonde-haired God, that pale-skinned God who blessed them to kidnap you and me and bring us here and make us slaves. When I use the term God, I'm speaking about our God, the God of our people, the God of our forefathers, the black man's God. In fact, I'm speaking about the black God, the supreme being, Almighty Allah himself. And anytime anyone teaches you to believe in a God that doesn't look like you, you give them that God back.
We don't want to be around that old pale thing. We don't want to integrate with that old pale thing. We don't want to sleep next to that old pale thing. No, we can do without it. You find that old pale thing laying out in the sun, trying to get to look like you. That old pale thing. You find him using man tan, trying to look like you. That old pale thing. That old sickly looking thing. And today we see him like he is. There was a time when we used to drool in the mouth over white people. We thought they were pretty because we were blind. We were dumb. We couldn't see them as they are. But since the Honorable Elijah Muhammad has come and taught us the religion of Islam, which has cleaned us up and made us so we can see for ourselves, now we can see that old pale thing to look exactly as he looked. Nothing but an old pale thing.
Roxbury, I got my first slave at the Roseland Dance Hall, Shining Shoes. And on the side, I sold liquor, reefers, and women. I got my first conch laid on. Got me a sharp zoot suit. I jitterbugged and partied all night and stayed high all day. Got me a white chick and ran with the gamblers and pimps. To stay out of the draft, I sold sandwiches on the Boston to New York train. When Uncle Sam finally caught up with me, I put on a show like I was crazy. I told the psychiatrist I couldn't wait to get my hands on a gun so I could shoot me up a lot of crackers. I got my 4F. New York was heaven, and Harlem was seventh heaven. 5 minutes on Lenox Avenue with its smooth, big-time hustlers, and I had started on my life of crime.
When you asked, is most members of the Muslims in the lower income class, most Negroes in America are in the lower income class.
When you live in a poor neighborhood, you're living in an area where you have to have poor schools. When you have poor schools, you have poor teachers. When you have poor teachers, you get a poor education. Poor education, you can only work on a poor paying job. And that poor paying job enables you to live again in a poor neighborhood. So it's a very vicious cycle.
Anyone who has an appeal upon the majority of black people in this country would automatically have a large number of people from a low-income group. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad teaches us that the black man is the original man and has the independent ability to produce a brown man, red man, yellow man, or white man, which the very fact that he can produce all of the others and none of them can produce him makes him a man far superior with far more potential than the other men. And Mr. Muhammad says that In the end, the same black man who ruled in the beginning will rule in the end.
There's great interest in the fact that you have joined the Muslim religion. How long have you had this interest, Cassius?
Oh, for the past 6 years, I would say, after hearing a lot of teachings on Negro history and who we were before we got here. And one in one makes two.
You feel your affiliation with the Muslim religion, being a follower of the Muslim religion, had something to do with your winning the championship?
Well, I would say so. My religion is what the only thing that I can give me credit for pulling me through, because 99 out of 100 seemed to see no possibility of me winning. The newspaper reporters and everybody all over the world condemned me. They said it would be a mismatch, and everybody, couldn't nobody believe it. So my prayers to Allah and faith in my religion, living a clean, righteous life, I have to say that's what pulled me through.
Winner by a TKO in the seventh round, Play.
I don't have a mark on my face,
yeah.
And I'm upset, son, and listen, and I just turned 22 years old. I must be the greatest.
Malcolm X, I want to talk with you briefly about your affiliation with Cassius. How long have you known him?
About 3 years.
And have you been advising him as far as his religious affiliations are concerned?
Well, no, I don't give advice to anyone. He's my brother and my friend. I express what I know and understand around him, but he has a mind of his own and understanding of his own.
Don't let the white man speak for you, and don't let the white man fight for you.
Well, I think to teach a man to hate himself is much more criminal than teaching him to hate someone else. And look at you. Who taught you to hate yourself?
Right here, and they're open to each and every brother complete inspection. Get your hands off of that thing there. So you want to see the financial books, huh?
Yeah.
Well, there he is. There he is. You done see them. Had the meeting adjourned.
What makes the so-called Negro unable to stand on his own two feet? He has no self-confidence. He has no proud confidence in his own race. Because the white man destroyed your and my past. Destroyed our knowledge of our culture. And by having destroyed it, now we don't know we have any achievements, any accomplishments. And as long as you can be convinced that you never did anything, you can never do anything.
Dice, your papa talking to you now, Dice. Come on. Just hit it one more time.
Who's in there?
This is why the white man, his little children, he tells them about George Washington, Abraham Lincoln, all these white heroes. But we are never taught about any black hero. Only someone we're shown in history is my grandfather was picking cotton.
Picking cotton from the break of dawning till the day I'm through. Oh, Lord, that sun's baking, wearing me out with all the work I do.
Down, the tide goes up, the doctor gather around and they all begin to shout. Hey, hey, Uncle Dougie, the doctor speaks, the beat on the Mississippi
bus. Cotton picking don't move me. No. But when it comes to teaching the black people something about great black men who stood their ground, who were scientists, who were civilizers, who were fathers of culture and civilization, the white man has shrewdly written that role out of the textbook. And today, the effect that it has on you and me, we don't think we can stand on our own two feet.
Judge Rigdon, can I see you some, please?
Well, I'm pretty busy.
Yes, but I just want to ask if you heard about it.
Hear about what?
About over at my house, night before last.
Ooh, another baby?
Yes, you sure guessed that you heard.
What's his name?
Oh, we call him L.R. Lars Rigby Livingston.
Oh, named him after me, did you?
Yes, the Lars Rigby. I told my wife, Ethel, I said, honey, I know Judge Shell gonna be gratified.
Well, of course, yes, I appreciate the honor.
Yes, sir.
I suppose a compliment, and I ought to do something for it.
Yes, sir, that's what I thought, because...
You come over to my place tomorrow, and I'll give you a job.
Job?
Rake and leave.
Mm-hmm. I asked him for work.
We wake up, we clean up, and we stand up. And once we can stand up like a man on our own feet, we stop begging the white man. And we stop apologizing to the white man. We stop compromising with the white man. Then the world will look at us with recognition and respect. But as long as you run around here wearing the white man's name, bragging about you one of the Jones, or one of the Browns, or one of the Smiths, as long as you run around here bragging about your part in this so-called American democracy, then you will always be looked down upon as a chump by the white man. You never will be given recognition nor respect. Your problem will continue to go unsolved, and we'll still be in the same rut or ditch a thousand years from now that we're in right now.
Miss Virgie, please, ma'am. We all done come here to wish him any happy
returns.
That's it, many happy returns of the day. And we all done made you a dollar. Here it is, Miss Percy. There was more I had to say, but Emmy, I forgot it.
You said everything, Sally Ann. Don't you worry.
Come on.
I'll see you later. And I'll save you some cake.
Oh, you'll be waiting.
The Honorable Elijah Muhammad teaches us that it is time for you and me to stand up for ourselves. It is time for you and me to see for ourselves. It is time for you and me to hear for ourselves. And it is time for you and me to fight for ourselves. We don't need anybody today speaking for us, seeing for us, or fighting for us. We'll fight our own battles with the help of our God. As long as you are addicted to the vices of the white man, when you call on God, God doesn't hear your prayer. And the white man knows it. But the white man also knows that when you clean yourself up, straighten yourself up, and get on God's side and call on God, God has got to answer your call. Stealing runs rampant in Harlem. Gambling runs rampant in Harlem. All types of evils and vices that tear apart our community run rampant in Harlem. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad doesn't condemn the victim. He goes to work on the victim. He doesn't say that all of you should go to jail because you have fallen victim to the evils that white man has brought into the community. He teaches you and me the religion that God has given to him as the only cure for the evil habits the white man has brought here among us.
I'm the best example of what he can do to reform delinquency and criminal characteristics in any person.
Why are you an example of rehabilitation?
Well, those of you who know my own history know that prior to becoming a Muslim, I was an extreme delinquent. I was into everything that the white police and gangsters left over for the black criminal. I was into numbers, bootleg liquor, hot goods, women, dope. I sold the bodies of black women to white men and white women to black men. I steered white people from downtown to whatever kind of sin they wanted in Harlem. And I'll tell you, my best customers were always the officials, top police, clergymen, businessmen. Despite the fact that my own father was murdered by whites, I was blind enough to mix and socialize with them. I considered them gods and goddesses until Mr. Muhammad opened my eyes and enabled me to see them as a filthy race of devils. We stole to stay alive. I was caught when I was 21 and sentenced to 10 years in prison. That's where I first heard the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and they turned me around. Because the statement, "The white man is the devil," just clicked. It explained everything. Hire the widow of a crazy nigger. It struck me like a blinding light. You've got to be realistic, Malcolm. You're a nigger. You're a nigger. You're a nigger. I fell on my knees and pledged to Allah that I would tell the black man the true teachings of Islam and the white man the truth about his crimes.
He teaches us to obey the law, to respect law enforcement officers, as long as these law enforcement officers respect themselves and respect the law that they represent. In Los Angeles, California last year, the police shot Ronald Stokes through the heart. He was a Phi Beta Kappa Korean vet. Many of you thought that we should go right on out then and make war on the white man. You wanted to do it yourself, didn't you? Didn't you? You wanted some action then, didn't you? Because you don't like the idea of white people shooting black people down, do you? And you're ready to do something about it, aren't you? We know you are. And the white man should be thankful that God has given the Honorable Elijah Muhammad the control over his followers that he has, so that they can play it cool, calm, and collected, and leave it in the hands of God.
And when Mr. Muhammad says separate from the white man, you tell the public that he's teaching hate. Now, Martin Luther King says love the white man and integrate with him, and the white man sticks dogs on Martin Luther King. So what you find out here is the hypocrisy of the white. If you draw away from him, he'll accuse you of hate. And if you jump up to him, he'll accuse you of trying to get close to him too soon, and he puts his dogs on you. If the black man lays on his side, he's wrong. If the black man lays on his back, he's wrong. If the black man stands up, he's wrong. So the only thing in face of all that the black man can do is get away from the white man.
The Honorable Elijah Muhammad says that the hour or the time is running out right now. And America is facing judgment, just like Egypt was judged for enslaving the Hebrews and Babylon was judged for enslaving the Hebrews, and because they refused to let the Hebrews go along with Moses, God destroyed them. This was the judgment day in their day. Today, America is faced with the same thing. If she doesn't let us go with the Honorable Elijah Muhammad out of this country, then America will be destroyed just as surely as Egypt was destroyed and Babylon was destroyed.
When you have a philosophy or a gospel, I don't care whether it's a religious gospel, a political gospel, an economic gospel, or a social gospel, if it's not going to do something for you and me right here, right now, to hell with that gospel. So we have to have a new approach, a new appraisal. And this new appraisal and new approach has to be in tune with the reality of the conditions that we are in after having been thoroughly brainwashed by this blue-eyed white man. Some of them have brown eyes.
Being here in America doesn't make you an American. Being born here in America doesn't make you an American. Why, if birth made you American, you wouldn't need any legislation. You wouldn't need any amendments to the Constitution. No, I'm not an American. I'm one of the 22 million black people who are the victims of Americanism. One of the 22 million black people who are the victims of democracy. Nothing but disguised hypocrisy. And I see America through the eyes of a victim. I don't see any American dream. I see an American nightmare.
Supposed to be off the street by 10 o'clock.
If we shoot, we're going to shoot to kill.
There's been a lot of talk said recently because I was supposed to have said something about Negroes should buy rifles. White people have been buying rifles all their lives. No commotion.
Shut it off and get out of that car with your hand up. All of you, the one in the back seat, too. Get your hands up, I said. Drop that purse and get your hands up.
You can lift them higher than that, friend. Let's get them up there. First one drops their hands, dead man.
Get them up.
Get your hands up. Let's go. Come on. Right this way.
Officer, location. Location of arrest, officer.
Fighting in Vietnam. Come home and look what happened.
Let's go!
We are peaceful people. We are loving people. We love everybody who loves us. But we don't love anybody who doesn't love us. We're nonviolent with people who are nonviolent with us. But we are not nonviolent with anyone who is violent with us.
Anytime you demonstrate against segregation and a man has the audacity to put a police dog on you, kill that dog. Tell him, I'm telling you. Kill that dog. I say it, if they put me in jail tomorrow, kill that dog.
If you go to jail, so what? If you're black, you were born in jail. If you're black, you were born in jail. In the North as well as the South. Stop talking about the South. Long as you're south of the Canadian border, you're South. Here he is standing up in front of other people. Uncle Sam, with the blood of your and my mothers and fathers on his hands. With the blood dripping down his jaws like a bloody jawed wolf. No, no more days like those.
Referring to President Kennedy, I believe you call him a trickster?
He has to be a trickster. Even if he's the president, that doesn't stop him from being a trickster if he's making tricks. Anytime a man running for president tells Negroes what he's going to do for them when he gets in office, and after he gets in office, he has time to do something for everybody else except the people that put him in office, he tricked the people who put him in office. He has the time to take a stand against U.S. Steel, against Castro, against Khrushchev, against Laos and South Vietnam and all these other places all over the world. But when it comes the time to correcting the injustices that are being inflicted against Negroes in this country, Kennedy sits up there like Nero. He's fiddling while Birmingham is burning.
While the nation and the world mourned the death of President John F. Kennedy, black Muslim extremist Malcolm X, speaking today in Manhattan Center in New York City, called the president's assassination a case of chickens coming home to roost.
This statement is from Messenger Elijah Muhammad, the leader of the Muslims in America. Minister Malcolm Shabazz addressing a public meeting at Manhattan Center in New York City on Sunday, December the 1st, did not speak for the Muslims when he made comments on the death of the president, John F. Kennedy. He was speaking for himself and not Muslims in general. And Minister Malcolm has been suspended from public speaking for the time being.
I've been silent for the past 90 days because of some statements I made concerning the president of the United States. Which were distorted.
They were distorted?
And yes. And
what did you say, Malcolm?
Well, I said the same thing that everybody says, that his assassination was the result of the climate of hate.
But
only I said the chickens came home to roost, and which means the same thing.
You did not say that you were glad the president was killed.
No, that's what the press said.
Uh-huh.
What would I look like saying that I'm glad the president was killed?
Malcolm, this is your first public statement in that 90-day period, is it not?
First time I opened up my mouth in 90 days. That's why I'm talking so fast and so hearty.
You see it? You feel, however, that we're making progress in this country and worldwide?
No. I will never say that progress is being made. If you stick a knife in my back 9 inches and pull it out 6 inches, there's no progress. Mm-hmm. If you pull it all the way out, that's not progress. The progress is healing the wound that the blow made.
You have
they
no...
won't even admit the knife is there.
I did receive word from him that the 90-day suspension that I was under was not to be lifted, that it would remain indefinite. And as I...
When did this take place?
This past week. Mm-hmm. And so I just reached the conclusion that... I frankly didn't think that I would ever be an active member of the Nation of Islam anymore.
I'm a believer in the Honorable Elijah and follower of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Right. I'm still a Muslim. My religion is Islam. Right. I run into some obstacles in the Nation of Islam, and I feel that I can best serve the Honorable Elijah Muhammad's purpose and program and carry into existence what I feel, I understand, concerning his objectives better on the outside than I can on the inside. And now that I have the independence of action, it's my intention to work with everybody or against everybody, whatever the case may be, to try and get some kind of immediate solution to the problems that are confronting our people. I still believe the best thing for us to do is go back home to Africa. But while we're getting ready to go back, we've got to eat now, we've got to sleep now, we have to have some clothes now, our children have to go to school, and we need some place to work. So whatever kind of action program can be devised to get us the things that are ours by right, then I'm for that kind of action, no matter what the action is. The purpose of our organization is to start right here in Harlem, which has the largest concentration of people of African descent that exists anywhere on this earth. There are more Africans here in Harlem than exist in any city on the African continent, because that's what you and I are, Africans. Our African brothers have gained their independence faster than you and I here in America have. They've also gained recognition and respect as human beings much faster than you and I. Just 10 years ago on the African continent, our people were colonized. They were suffering all forms of colonization, oppression, exploitation, degradation, humiliation, discrimination, and every other kind of Asian. And in a short time, they have gained more independence, more recognition, more respect as human beings than you and I have. And you and I live in a country which is supposed to be the citadel of education, freedom, justice, democracy, and all of those other pretty sounding words. New bridges must be built, because in the minds of the majority of our people today, Africa is too far away. So the only way you and I can point them in that direction is build new bridges. We have to have the type of understanding of Africa and the type of understanding of our people here in order to build a bridge, a contact, a line of communication between the two. And once the lines of communication have been established, and our African brothers can stretch forth their hands and reach us, and we can stretch forth our hands and reach them, why, there's nothing that this blue-eyed man in this country will be able to do to you and me successfully from that day onward. I don't think when a man is being criminally treated that some criminal has the right to tell that man what tactics to use to get the criminal off his back. When a criminal starts misusing me, I am going to use whatever necessary to get that criminal off my back. Don't blame a cracker in Georgia for your injustices. The government is responsible for the injustices.
Pan Am Flight 115 from Cairo, arriving 425. Passengers now unloading at gate 6.
Malcolm, have your experiences with white-skinned Muslims in Africa and the Middle East made you feel that relations between Negroes and whites who are not Muslims is any more possible?
When I was on the pilgrimage, I had close contact with Muslims whose skin would in America be classified as white, and with Muslims who themselves would be classified as white in America. But these particular Muslims didn't call themselves white. They looked upon themselves as human beings, as part of the human family, and therefore they looked upon all other segments of the human family as part of that same family. Well, now, they had a different look or a different air or a different attitude than that which is reflected in the attitude of the man in America who calls himself white. So I said that if Islam had done that for them, perhaps if the white man in America would study Islam, perhaps it could do the same thing for him.
At Jeddah in Saudi Arabia on the way to Mecca, I remember the ancient words of Allah. Proclaim the pilgrimage among men. They will come on foot and upon lean camel. They will come from every deep ravine. From Mecca, the holy city of Islam, I wrote to friends in America. Never have I witnessed such sincere hospitality and true brotherhood as is practiced here in this ancient holy land, the home of Abraham, Muhammad, and all the other prophets of the Holy Scriptures. You may be shocked at these words coming from me, but what I have seen has forced me to rearrange much of my thought patterns previously held, to toss aside some of my previous conclusions. For during the past 11 days, I've eaten from the same plate, drunk from the same glass, slept on the same rug, and prayed to the same God with fellow Muslims whose eyes were the bluest of blue, whose hair was the blondest of blonde, and whose skin was the whitest of white. We are truly the same because their belief in one God has removed the white from their minds, the white from their behavior, and the white from their attitudes. Wearing the ihram garb of a pilgrim, I made the seven circuits around the Kaaba. I drank from the sacred well of Zemzem. I ran between the hills of Safa and Marwa. I stood on Mount Ararat and with my brothers proclaimed, "I come, O Lord, I come. God is great. Lead us, O Lord, in peace." And for the first time in my 39 years on this earth, I stood before the Creator of all and felt like a complete human being. Sincerely, El Haj Malik El Shabazz, Malcolm X.
I think a lot of people confused by the new Arabic name, El Haj Malik El Shabazz.
I've always had the name on my passport, Malik El Shabazz, only I only used it in the Muslim world. Well, Hajj is a title that is given to any Muslim who makes the pilgrimage to Mecca during the official Hajj season.
Well, will you now use Shabazz and drop X?
I'll probably continue to use Malcolm X because, and I'll probably use it as long as the situation that produced it exists.
you don't feel that Shabazz takes the place of X?
My going to Mecca and going into the Muslim world, into the African world, and being recognized and accepted as a Muslim and as a brother may solve the problem for me personally. But I personally feel that my personal problem is never solved as long as the problem is not solved for all of our people in this country. So I remain Malcolm X as long as there is a need to protest and struggle and fight against the injustices that our people are involved in this country.
Are you prepared to go into the United Nations at this point and ask that charges be brought against the United States for its treatment of American Negroes?
Oh, yes. Please.
I think you're right in my chair.
The audience will have to be quiet. As I pointed out when I was during my traveling, that African nations and Asian nations and Latin American nations look very hypocritical when they stand up in the United Nations condemning the racist practices of South Africa and that which is practiced by Portugal and Angola, and saying nothing in the UN about the racist practices that are manifest every day against Negroes in this society. Even in South Africa, those Africans aren't faced with bayonets and aren't faced with police dogs. I would be not a man. If I was in a position to bring it in front of the United Nations and didn't do so, I wouldn't be a man.
Malcolm, do you intend to lead the charge in the United Nations?
Well, I find that to say you're going to lead something creates a lot of hostility, division, jealousy, and envy. I hope to work with any group of leaders or any group of organizations to do whatever is necessary to see that this problem is brought before the United Nations.
Have you had any commitments from any nations in Africa to support you in this move?
I would rather not say at this time, but one thing I found in my travels, all of them look upon us as their long-lost brother.
You realize the implication is that you have had such commitments when you say...
This is your interpretation of what I said. One thing that I found in all of my travels was that all of the Africans, not only the Africans, but the Asians and the Muslims, look upon us as their long-lost brothers. And America had actually tricked many of them into a hands-off policy by giving them the impression that she was honestly trying to do something to solve the problem. My argument over there was designed to prove that it is impossible
for the United States government to solve the race problem. It's impossible.
Malcolm, on your trip abroad, you said you sensed a feeling of great brotherhood and that conceivably you would be working toward integration in this country now. At least this is what you're reported to have said. Have you any comment on it?
I don't think that I ever mentioned anything about working toward integration. They haven't even got integration right here in New York City. You have worse integration problems in the North than they have in the South. So if it doesn't work, if you can't bring about integration in New York City as international, cosmopolitan, up-to-date as it's supposed to be, you will never get integration anywhere else in the country.
Are you prepared to work with some of the leaders of the other civil rights organizations?
Certainly. Certainly. We will work with any groups, organizations, or leaders in any way, as long as it's genuinely designed to get results.
Does your new beard have any religious significance?
No, not particularly, but I do think that you'll find black people in America, as they strive to throw off the shackles of mental colonialism, will also probably reflect an effort to throw off the shackles of cultural colonialism. And they may begin to reflect desires of their own, with standards of their own.
Malcolm, your more controversial remarks was a call for black people to get rifles and form rifle clubs some time back. Do you still favor that for self-defense?
I don't see why that should be controversial. I think that if white people found themselves the victim of the same kind of brutality that black people in this country face, and they saw that the government was either unwilling or unable to protect them, that the intelligence on the part of the whites would make them get some rifles and shotguns and protect themselves. Now, Negroes are developing some kind of intellectual maturity, too. And they can see that having waited upon the government to protect them has been a wait that has been in vain. So any of them who live in areas where the government is not able to do its job, then we do have to get together and do a job of protecting ourselves.
No Negro leaders have fought for civil rights.
What do you mean
they have
fought?
Begged for civil rights. They have begged the white man for civil rights. They have begged the white man for freedom. And anytime you beg another man to set you free, you will never be free. Freedom is something that you have to do for yourselves. And until the American Negro lets the white man know that we are really, really ready and willing to pay the price that is necessary for freedom, our people will always be walking around here second-class citizens, or what you call 20th century slaves.
What price are you talking about, sir?
The price of freedom is death.
Now, I'd like for Medgar to know, too, that since he's been gone, the wheel ain't stopped. We've still been chopping them down with their hate and with all that guns, but they ain't stopped us, and they ain't gonna stop us.
When we get to Montgomery, we want to hold council with Mr. Watt.
Yes! Yeah. Yeah.
We don't have a fight with the Ku Klux Klan.
No!
We got a fight with these folks over here in this corner.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, I know that some of them probably was out under some of the sheets themselves.
Yeah.
Now we have the type of black man on the scene in America today who just doesn't intend to turn the other cheek any longer.
We want to let the whole world know that we are going to pick our heroes from today on.
You'll never see me stand up and tell this thing national anthem represents me.
We want to turn on the gas. We want to turn on the water. We want to sell the clothes. We want to sell the cars. We want to be men. We want self-determination.
Back during slavery, when black people like me talked to the slaves, they didn't kill them. They'd send some old house Negro along behind him to undo what he said. You have to read the history of slavery to understand this. There were two kinds of Negroes. There was that old house Negro and the field Negro. And the house Negro always looked out for his master. When the field Negroes got too much out of line, he held them back in check. He put them back on the plantation. The house Negro could afford to do that because he lived better than the field Negro. He ate better, he dressed better, and he lived in a better house. He lived right up next to his master in the attic or the basement. He ate the same food his master ate and wore his same clothes. And he could talk just like his master, good diction. And he loved his master more than his master loved himself. That's why he didn't want his master hurt. If the master got sick, he'd say, "What's the matter, boss? We sick?" When the master's house caught a fire, he'd try and put the fire out. He didn't want his master's house burned. He never wanted his master's property threatened. And he was more defensive of it than the master was. That was the house Negro. But then you had some field Negroes who lived in huts, had nothing to lose. They wore the worst kind of clothes. They ate the worst food. And they caught hell. They felt the sting of the lash. They hated their master. Oh, yes, they did. If the master got sick, they prayed that the master died. If the master's house caught a fire, they prayed for a strong wind to come along. This was the difference between the two. And today, you still have house Negroes and field Negroes. Yeah. I'm a field Negro.
The dark people are waking up. They're losing their fear of the white man. No place right now where he's fighting is he winning. Everywhere he's fighting someone your and my complexion. And they're beating him. He can't win anymore. Nowhere on this earth does a white man win in a guerrilla warfare. It's not his feat. It takes heart to be a guerrilla warrior. A guerrilla is on his own. All you have is a rifle, some sneakers, and a bowl of rice. And that's all you need. And a lot of heart. I just want to give you a little briefing on guerrilla warfare because before you know it,
I hope I haven't put anybody on the spot. I'm not intending to try and stir you up and make you do something that you wouldn't have done anyway. I pray that God will bless you in everything that you do. I pray that you will grow intellectually so that you can understand the problems of the world and where you fit into in that world picture. And I pray that all the fear that has ever been in your heart will be taken out. And when you look at that man, if you know he's nothing but a coward, you won't fear him. If he wasn't a coward, he wouldn't gang up on you. He wouldn't need to sneak around here. How they function. They function in mobs. That's a coward. They put on a sheet so you won't know who they are. That's a coward. No. The time will come when that sheet will be ripped off. If the federal government doesn't take it off, we'll take it off.
Thank you. I think you'll find that if Negroes ever have to resort to any kind of physical action to defend themselves, many white people will be on the side of Negroes. Many white people are fed up with what the Negroes suffer. And this is what I had to become aware of on my pilgrimage to Mecca. I could see then that there are many white people in this country who will side with the Negro in whatever he has to do to protect himself.
But that's a considerable change of opinion in Malcolm X.
No, today I'm speaking for myself. Formerly, I spoke for Elijah Muhammad. And everything I said was, Elijah Muhammad teaches us thus and so. I'm speaking now from what I think, from what I have seen, from what I have analyzed, and the conclusions that I have reached.
Then the white man is no longer the devil, and he is no longer bound to be evil?
If I judge a man by his conscious behavior, I am not a racist. I don't subscribe to any of the tenets of racism.
Then there are good whites and good blacks and bad whites and blacks.
It's not a case of being good and bad, good or bad blacks and whites. It's a case of being good or bad human beings.
Do you feel that your message, apparent message of love that you brought back from Islam is the real reason they're after you, because you're not hating as hard as they want you to?
Well, I never did hate anybody hard. But I do know that when I wrote that letter saying that there were white people in Mecca, it shook up a lot of Muslims, because most of the Muslims who follow Mr. Muhammad absolutely believed that it was impossible, physically impossible, I should say divinely impossible, for a white person to go to Mecca. And my trip there shattered that image or that misconception.
Anyone call you directly, Malcolm?
I've been receiving calls ever since I left the Black Most in the movement.
And what sort of calls, Malcolm? You're disenchanted in view of the fact that these men who were your brothers are making threats against your life?
No, because actually it's not their fault. Most of them, now Joseph and the officials, they have a knowledge of what it's all about. But the rank-and-file Muslim brother does not know what it's all about. They are, out of religious sincerity, they think that they are doing the will of Allah by protecting a man who I myself taught them was divine. So I don't in any way fault them. But those who are over them and give the orders, and actually the ultimate order comes from Elijah Muhammad himself.
I think someone should say something to speak out against the acts of my blood brother Malcolm. Since I'm one of those who brought my brother Malcolm to Islam, I'm taking this task on myself. Because I see where my brother Malcolm, angered by the little misfortune of being suspended for speaking out of turn and against instruction, now resorts to slander, slurs, and intimidations of Mr. Muhammad, Mr. Muhammad's family, and the Muslim followers of Mr. Muhammad.
As long as I represented the Black Muslim movement as an example of morality, unity, and militancy, as long as I could do that, I represented it. It was when I realized that it could not be represented as that, that I came on and started working among the non-Muslim Negroes, as I announced in January, and I had no intention, or rather March, and I had no intention of ever even speaking on this. Had they left me alone, you still wouldn't know what really took place.
Because now I see my brother pursue a dangerous course which parallels that of the precedent set by Judas, Brutus, and Benedict Arnold, and others who betray the honor and trust relationship between them and their leaders.
Why are they threatening your life?
Well, primarily because they're afraid that I will tell the real reason that they've been, that I'm out of the Black Muslim movement, which I never told. I kept to myself. But the real reason is that Elijah Muhammad, the head of the movement, is the father of 8 children by 6 different teenage girls, 6 different teenage girls who were his private personal secretary. But the one who first made me aware of this was Wallace Muhammad, Mr. Muhammad's son.
Because I am aware of the great mental illness which besets, unfortunately, many in America, and which besetted my mother, whom I love, and many of my other brothers, and which now may have taken another victim, my brother Malcolm.
And I had stated in a newspaper article about an effort to take my life back in January, and at that time the Muslims denied it. In fact, they tried to make it appear to my brother that I was insane. But on a program in Chicago called Hotline, that's moderated by Wesley South, Don Ali, the national secretary, admitted, I think it was Wednesday or Thursday, one of these days last week, that they absolutely were going to kill me.
What steps would you take to protect yourself from this threat?
I take no steps. I have a rifle. If anybody comes to my house without a good reason, I intend to try and use it. And that's all.
Now, he has told me that he was having some harassment. Could you give me an idea of some of the things that have happened?
Well, in July, when I was in the hospital having my last baby, my 3 small daughters saw my husband almost killed across the street. I called the 114th precinct a few days ago. They informed me that it was nothing they could do.
Few of these threats, are you concerned about your own life right now?
No, I don't worry. I tell you, I'm a man who believed that I died 20 years ago. And I live like a man who is dead already. I have no fear whatsoever of anybody or anything.
This is Leon Amir, who was Cassius Clay's secretary, whom they beat unmercifully up in Boston.
I was attacked by them in Boston on December the 25th in the hotel lobby of the Sherry Biltmore Hotel. And they're still after me.
And it was he who heard Elijah Muhammad Jr. come to New York when Elijah Muhammad was at the Armory in June of last year. Jr. stood up and told the fruit, many of whom are here now also, that I should have been killed, that my tongue should have been put in an envelope and sent back to Chicago by now. And then Clarence, the captain from Boston, and John, the captain from Springfield, came to New York to assassinate me and came to him to get a silencer. And couldn't get it. So the police know this. It's not something that's new. They just wait until the job is done and then they step in.
You mean he was going to kill you?
Oh, yes. One of them was, an attempt was made to get one of them to wire my car with an explosive.
That one is with me right now.
Are you not perhaps afraid of what might happen to you as a result of making these revelations?
Oh, yes. I probably am a dead man already.
I wanted you to know that my house was bombed. It was bombed by the black Muslim movement upon the orders of Elijah Muhammad. Now, they had come around, they had planned to do it from the front and the back so that I couldn't get out. They covered the front completely, the front door. Then they had come to the back, but instead of getting in directly in the back of the house and throwing it this way, they stood at a 45-degree angle and tossed it at the window, so it glanced and went onto the ground.
I don't know if I woke my husband up or he woke me up, but I remember him pushing me out of the bedroom door, and I looked to my right, and I saw all of the fire.
And the fire hit the window, and it woke up my second oldest baby. But the fire burned on the outside of the house. But had that one gone through that window, it would have fallen on a 6-year-old girl, a 4-year-old girl, and a 2-year-old girl. And I'm going to tell you, if it had done it, I'd taken my rifle and gone after anybody in sight. I would not wait.
The house itself has been the object of controversy between Malcolm and black Muslims. The Muslims contend they own the property and have gone to court to evict Malcolm.
We have been trying to get the property back through legal means. And today, the 15th of February, we were due the final ruling on the property, which came through favorable to the Muslims.
The police know the criminal operation of the black Muslim movement because they have thoroughly infiltrated it.
Well, Malcolm claims you did it. You claim you didn't do it. Who do you feel bombed the house?
Well, it could be a publicity act.
Are you inferring then that Malcolm may have bombed his own home with his family in it?
We hope that it's not a case of if he can't have it, we can't either.
That's what I said. The Muslims claim I bombed my house. And if anybody can find where I bombed my house, they can put a rifle bullet through my head. It was my children and my own life and my wife's life that was at stake. You know what the degree, what temperature was? It was about 15 or 20. I stood in my underwear, bare feet, in the middle of my driveway with a gun in my hand for 45 minutes waiting for the police or waiting for the fire department to come. If I want to put on a show, I can find a better way than that to put it on. And if you attack me, that's one thing. I know what to do when you start attacking me. But when you attack sleeping babies while you are lower than a guy... The only thing that I regret in all of this is that two black groups have to fight and kill each other off. I feel responsible for having played a major role in developing a criminal organization. It was not a criminal organization at the outstart. It was an organization that had the power, the spiritual power, to reform the criminal. And this is what you have to understand. As long as that strong spiritual power was in the movement, it gave the moral strength to the believer that would enable him to rise above all his negative tendencies. I know, because I went into the movement with more negative tendencies than anybody in the movement. And just faith in what I was taught what made it possible for me to stop doing anything that I was doing and everything that I was doing. And I saw thousands of brothers and sisters come in who were in the same condition. And whatever they were doing, they would stop it overnight, just through faith and faith alone. And by this spiritual force, giving one the faith that enabled one to exercise the moral discipline, it became an organization that was to be respected as well as feared. I, for one, disassociate myself from the movement completely, and I dedicate myself to the organizing of black people into a group that are interested in doing things constructive, not for just one religious segment of the community, but for the entire black community. Soon as we establish our religious authenticity with the Muslim world, we set up the Organization of Afro-American Unity and took immediate steps to make certain that we would be in direct contact with our African brothers on the African continent. So the first step that has been taken, brothers and sisters, since Garvey died, to actually establish contact between the 22 million the 22 million black Americans with our brothers and sisters back home was done by two organizations. And you know we've got to unite with them because there are 700 million Muslims. And we sure need to stop being the minority and become part of the majority.
One of the things that's going to help to bring this about is the independence of Africa. One of the only reasons in that we in the West have never organized, we have hated our image and our African image. And because Africa has been in the hands of people who have created an image of Africa that's negative and hateful. And it has been hateful to us. We haven't wanted to identify with it. But now that Africa is getting independent and in a position to create its own image, and it's a positive image, those of us in the West look at the African image and see how positive it is. We begin to identify with it. We become proud of Africa, and we become proud of our African blood, our African heritage. And this is what is beginning to make the Africans in the Western Hemisphere today develop more race pride. And as this race pride develops, then it has a tendency to make us want to unite together and work together. And your Western imperialists and colonialists consider this to be a grave threat.
Today, for the first time, the black people of the West are beginning to look homeward. They're beginning to look back toward the mother continent of Africa, and they're gaining spiritual strength from these roots. The African continent is on the rise. The motherland is on the rise, fighting and seeking and fighting for his place in the sun. But his fight is putting the same spirit in the black people in the West, and we are also seeking and fighting for our place in the sun, and we will not rest until that place has been secured.
What's your plan now?
I'm going back to the States first and see how my family is doing.
Yes.
I've got a family there. And see what develops.
I had gotten an invitation to visit Paris from the Afro-American community in Paris, which was sponsoring a rally in conjunction with the African community. When I got to Paris, the man said I couldn't come in. Some man, French man. They gave me no explanation other than to say, we have our orders. They wouldn't let me phone the American embassy, and they tried to imply that the American embassy was behind it, which I told them that I didn't know that France was a satellite of the United States. Well, this made them angry because they like to be independent, you know, or pretend to be independent. They were taking their orders from someone as high up in the French Foreign Ministry who did not want me to enter France, and there's a reason for it. I don't blame them. And I told them while I was there that maybe my plane got mixed up and I was in South Africa in the wrong country. I told them this couldn't be Paris, it must be Johannesburg. And they got red. And you know how they can get red. There's a large, increasing number of dark-skinned people swelling the dark population of France and Britain, and it's giving them a great deal of cause for worry. No effort has been made to unite the Afro-American community or the American Negro community with the West Indian community, and then those two communities with the African community, and those communities with the Asian community. This has never been done. And this frightened many interests in this country. Many people in this country who want to see us the minority and who don't want to see us taking too militant or too uncompromising a stand are absolutely against the successful regrouping or organizing of any faction in this country whose thought and whose thinking pattern is international rather than national. And then if this man over here plays too rough, we got some brothers who can play as rough as he. There's a worldwide revolution going on. It goes beyond Mississippi. It goes beyond Alabama. It goes beyond Harlem. What is it revolting against? The power structure. The American power structure? No. The French power structure? No. The English power structure? No. Then what power structure? An international Western power structure. So our next move is to take the entire civil rights struggle problem into the United Nations and let the world see that Uncle Sam is guilty of violating the human rights of 22 million Afro-Americans and still has the audacity or the nerve to stand up and represent himself as the leader of the free world. There'll be a hot time in the old town. With regret, with great regret. Now, I am well aware of what I'm setting in motion by what I'm saying up here tonight. I'm well aware. But I have never said or done anything in my life that I wasn't prepared to suffer the consequences for.
first time when I can save women and children from being shot down in the street, and if you're not, you're nothing but a fool.
We cannot take the law into our hands. We pay officers to protect us.
We declare our right on this earth to be a man, to be a human being, to be respected as a human being, to be given the rights of a human being in this society, on this earth, in this day, which we intend to bring into existence by any means.
About the first third of the audience shouted, "Come out of my pocket, come out of my pocket." And I heard my husband say, "Everything is all right, everything is all right." And someone about third or so seated in about the third row stood up, and I heard shots, and I saw people crawling on the floor. And so I got down too. But then when I was looking out and I saw someone look in amazement to the front, I knew they had shot my husband.
Was he in on arrival?
He was dead on arrival, and they took him into the third floor emergency room, and several doctors tried to revive him for about 15 minutes, and there was no response. I mean, he was pronounced dead at 3:30.
Has the body been identified?
When it was brought in, we didn't get a positive identification. We admitted the patient as John Doe.
He raised his hand and a Muslim greeting, Salaam Alaikum. At that point, I heard a rumbling behind me, and I turned around in my seat to see what it was. Then we saw, I saw two guys standing up, and the next thing, Malcolm had his hand up. He said, "Stay cool, stay calm." Just then, the gunfire went off, and his hand was up. I remember this. I turned around quickly, and the next thing I saw was Malcolm falling back in a dead faint. The chairs were being knocked over. There were screams. Everybody was in a mad confusion. I incidentally saw a guy running out, evidently one of the perpetrators running out, and he was shooting like a cowboy.
Let's start from the beginning, huh?
All right.
You fellas start asking questions.
Right.
If you want the story, I'll give it to you.
All right.
Forget it. Okay.
You can describe
what
happened.
All right. That's right.
You ready?
Ready?
Roll.
Chief, could you describe what happened here today?
At about 3:15 p.m. This afternoon, there were about 400 persons present in the ballroom here representing an organization known as the Afro-American Unity Organization, headed up by Malcolm X. Malcolm was addressing the audience from the speaker's platform when apparently two men approached the speaker's rostrum and discharged shots at him from apparently very close range.
How many shots were there, Chief?
Apparently there were at least 8 or 10 shots fired, 7 of which hit Malcolm.
Were they all pistol shots, sir?
I'm not certain at this time whether they were all pistol shots. We did recover a sawed-off shotgun near the speaker's platform.
Where was Malcolm hit?
He sustained one shot in the lower right chin, and the other 6 hit him in the chest and body.
When did you see your husband last?
Well, yesterday he was going to check in at a hotel to be able to get some work done that he wanted to get done, that he couldn't get done where we are staying because it's crowded. We moved in with friends after our house was bombed. He called me last night and said that he had picked up his typewriter and that he was going to get the work done. And he called me, and I asked him before he left if I could come to the meeting. I said, can I come to the meeting tomorrow? And he says, no. And then today he called me, and he says that he'd like for me to come to the meeting, and he'd like for me to bring all of the children.
How many suspects do you have?
We are not calling anyone at this moment suspect. We have witnesses whom we are questioning.
How many witnesses?
I am not going to state how many witnesses
Mr.
at this
Hagen.
Time.
Are the witnesses you're holding Muslims?
I will not comment on anyone's religious beliefs.
What was the status of police protection at the Malcolm X's speech today?
We had a complement of police assigned, but only to the outside.
There were no police at this meeting then, were there, Inspector?
There were no uniformed policemen assigned inside this ballroom.
Have you taken measures to protect the family of Malcolm X, his widow?
We have.
Do you fear for your own life and the lives of your children?
Yes.
Since the bombing of your home, have the police made any effort to offer you protection?
Well, I guess they did make an effort, yes.
Do you want police protection? Mrs. Shabazz, do you believe it was the black Muslims who assassinated your husband?
Would you say flatly that no black Muslims were involved in the shooting of Malcolm X?
I wasn't there, but I don't believe that any of my followers was there. Had nothing to do with it at all. Way I see it, Malcolm is the victim of his own preaching. He preached violence, and so he became the victim of it.
The assassination of Malcolm X was an unfortunate tragedy, and it reveals that there are still numerous people in our nation who have degenerated to the point of expressing dissent through murder, and we haven't learned to disagree without being violently disagreeable.
I am not convinced, however, that Elijah Muhammad and the black Muslims had anything to do with his killing. I think that we'll find that it runs much deeper than that.
Malcolm X, last week, sought to make contact with the State Department to discuss threats against his life. I note that he said in a press interview last week also that he was practically dead. He was going to be killed because he knew too much. These things raise questions in my mind. What did he know that was about to bring about his death? Why did he consider the matter to be a responsibility which should be brought to the attention of the State Department? It seems to me that these questions are serious enough to require a federal investigation into the circumstances surrounding Malcolm X's murder. We are therefore urging upon the federal government, upon the president indeed, that there be a federal inquiry launched by the proper federal agency into the circumstances surrounding the assassination.
Whom do you blame for your brother's death?
I will quote my brother the day before he died, referring to the bombing of his house. He stated that he felt the bombing of his home was much bigger than the black Muslims. 1 week later, he was assassinated. If he felt that the bombing was bigger than the black Muslims, then I feel that possibly his assassination was bigger than the black Muslims.
The American system killed my brother. The hatred, the cultivated hatred, the desire on to lust for power, the desire to control, the desire to hinder progress, to profess freedom and then block it.
what do you think of Malcolm X's death?
I know it was no accident.
Who do you believe is responsible for Malcolm X's death?
The white power structure in America is behind it. They're quick to capitalize on by saying that one of his own kind did it, but they put it up to be done.
What do you mean, the white power structure?
The white power structure of America. They know they had more to gain by getting Malcolm X out the way than they had by letting him live. That's why I say.
But what is the white power structure?
Never mind. I just said the white power structure. You know the white race, don't you?
In the last year, like Roy Wilkins said, he changed. He wanted to get along with the white people. But you people didn't want to get along with us.
What does Malcolm X's death mean to you? What do you feel about it?
What do you feel about me?
What do you feel about
it? It's a blow to have a black people in the United States of America. Black!
It's what?
It's a blow, he said.
It's a blow.
Blow, he said.
Yes.
He says it's a blow to every black American, black people in the United States. That's what he was saying.
Why is it a blow to you?
Because he's a part of me. Because he looks like me. And his skin is me. He's a black man, and I'm a black man. And he takes up a black man's patience.
That's right. That's right.
He was a hero to me. He stood out among all black people.
That's
he
right.
showed the white man where it was at.
Well, why was he a hero?
He got respect. Too. Why was he off it in Princeton and all these big white universities? Because they respected him too, the way I respected him.
That's
he meant
right.
something to me. That's why I'm down here.
That's right.
Well, they killed Malcolm X for they hadn't right killing him.
He
that's
was right.
for me and he I was think for him. Right. If you kill him, there's gonna be more killing going
he
on.
That's
you
right.
call him, I call him.
And you're saying that you believe this was paid for by whites?
Yes, by white people. Because what? What? What would it benefit? What would it benefit one of us to kill him? It wouldn't benefit nothing. Wouldn't benefit us anything at all. Just a white power structure of this country. Anytime a black man in this country stands up for his constitutional rights, he dies.
What did Malcolm X mean to you?
He meant a great deal to me and my people. I'm sorry that a good man is gone. At the first idea of it, I couldn't have cried anymore. I don't believe if I had lost my mother.
What did he mean to you? Can you tell me a bit more about it?
He meant deliverance for my people. And I hope we all walk in the same footsteps as Malcolm X was walking in.
Here, at this final hour, in this quiet place, Harlem has come to bid farewell to one of its brightest hopes, extinguished now and gone from us forever. For Harlem is where he worked and where he struggled and fought, his home of homes, where his heart was and where his people are. And it is therefore most fitting that we meet once again in Harlem to share these last moments with him. For Harlem has ever been gracious to those who have loved her, have fought for her, and have defended her honor even to the death. It is not in the memory of man that this beleaguered, unfortunate, but nonetheless proud community has found a braver, more gallant young champion than this Afro-American who lies before us, unconquered still. Many will ask what Harlem finds to honor in this stormy, controversial, and bold young captain, and we will smile, and we will answer and say unto them, did you ever talk to Brother Malcolm? Did he ever touch you? Did you have him smile at you? Did you ever really listen to him? Did he ever do a mean thing? Was he ever himself associated with violence or any public disturbance? For if you did, you would know him. And if you knew him, you would know why we must honor him. Malcolm was our manhood, our living black manhood. That was his meaning to his people. And in honoring him, we honor the best in ourselves. And we will know him then for what he was and is, a prince, our black shining prince, who didn't hesitate to die because he loved us so.
To be respected as a human being, to be given the rights of a human being in this society, on this earth, in this day, which we intend to bring into existence by any means necessary.